It has been a while. Sorry about that. School certainly hasn't left me much of free time, but also this game. Not often do I come across with something this emotionally raw that sometimes you just have to give longer breaks to unwind it all. I'm of course referring to the 2015 point-and-click adventure sleeper hit, Life is Strange.
The game's story is written by Jean-Luc, whose creative endeavors have focused on other games in this series, as is the case with the other writer Christian Devine and its directors Raoul Barbet and Michel Koch. The game became known for featuring down-to-earth subject matters that, while not necessarily being the main focus of the plot, have before this seen largely as taboos in the gaming hemisphere, and you're going to hear about those soon, so brace yourself mentally. The events take place in the autumn of 2013, when our lead, the art student Maxine Caulfield, played by Hannah Tell, experiences an apocalyptic vision in the middle of a photography class. As you do. The class ends and immediately we get a sample of the game's distinct presentation, and I'm not just referring to the graphics that have this slight painting vibe to them. This cinematic sequence through school hall with some somber acoustic guitar song playing, while Max gives thoughtful slash snarky commentary on other students and teachers, makes me feel like I've stepped into an indie movie. Soon though, Max witnesses some shady dealings.
So what do you want?
I hope you check the perimeter, as my step-ass would say. Now, let's talk business.
I got nothing for you.
Wrong. You got hella cash.
Oh yes, that infamous youthling that the game's detractors often point out as the reason why they can take the writing seriously. It has been speculated to be the result of the writing team's language barrier. Struggle that I can certainly sympathize with. However, I'd like to suggest that perhaps it's an intentional choice, because the writing style reminds me of the pseudo-intellectual style some of the greatest indie movie classics have, like Juno or Little Miss Sunshine, with some added melancholy mysticism a la Another World. Admittedly, some of the word choices feel off, but I don't think they're bad or frequent enough to ruin the experience for me.
The supernatural side of the plot is put on move when, after witnessing a person getting shot, Max realizes she can travel through time into the past, but only for a short period. The first function of this core mechanic is to ponder between different choices that, once deciding which one to take, are going to stick, and you have to accept the effects they have to the story. Well, kind of, but I'll get to that later. However, this is where the game's technical crudeness is shown, as rewinding during these segments caused the most glitches, especially if the player character model happened to be in an awkward place, once forcing me to reload the save. The other function is to rewind after failures, and I know that in the past I've criticized games that do an in-universe explanation for the lack of consequences, but in this case it cleverly supports the narrative and puzzle solving. Getting supernatural abilities at such a young age can be overwhelming, and it's easy to forget how to use them properly if you're not used to it. Like here where a bird died and I tried to look for an item to help the poor thing as I would do in any other game of this genre, and too late I remembered that, oh yeah, Max has time travel powers. Other than that though, I managed to keep notes on smaller details.
Oh, I'm sorry, Lisa. I saved Kate, but I drowned my own plant.
God damn it!
Once in a while you do have items at your disposal, but that's pretty much the extension of the game mechanics. Some have gone as far as to say them lackluster, but they had enough functionality in them to satisfy my logic coordination needs. It is not as complex as in some of the older point-and-click classics, but I appreciate the non-cryptic smoothness of it all. Besides, the gameplay mechanics were the developers' secondary focus point, because they were putting most of their time to fine-tuning the narrative elements, so let's take a deeper look at them.
The young lady whose life Max saved turns out to be her childhood best friend Chloe Price, played by Ashley Burse in her role of a lifetime, who has since the last time she met her 5 years ago changed into a more, let's just say, rebellious type. She has had some rebel-related substance dealings with the relentless son of a prick Nathan Prescott, played by Nick Schreiner, whose rich family owns pretty much the entirety of Arcadia Bay, but more important than that, and the various unexplained unnatural phenomenon, is figuring out the mystery of Chloe's replacement best friend Rachel Amber's disappearance. Chloe is another big point of content due to her clingy and aggressive never my fault personality. Some even suggesting that the game tries to force players to like her.
I don't know. I never felt that the game was wagging its finger through Chloe. Rather that Chloe the character was expressing her opinion from her warped perspective. Apparently it's possible to make these two to go full on romance, but I didn't do that because... you know how there are some people that would make for good friends, or at least semi-decent friends, but would be terrible as romantic partners? Yeah, Chloe Price is a textbook example of that due to being borderline possessive. But to the game's credit, there are instances from episode 3 onwards where Max can let her have it.
I gotta blame somebody, otherwise it's all my fault. Fuck that. Grow up! God, you're not the only one in Arcadia Bay with problems!
Mwah, so satisfying.
However, I'm not completely unsympathetic towards her due to her deeply rooted abandonment issues, and her stepfather David Madsen, played by Don McManus, can be a bit overbearing. Through her rough exterior, shades of a stand-up person occasionally crack through, and overall there are very few characters whose first impression matches the rest of their personality. Sure, Max's school has all the college cliches, from the dorky but still kind of cool guy, the rich bitch, the devout Christian, and so on, but those narrow roles only really fit for the first episode. After that, I was completely invested on how the choices I had Maxine make affected to their lives and let me see new sides from them. Only once I used hard reset to prevent autosave from triggering because... yeah, I did not want that on my conscience.
This game has indeed some heavy stuff in it. And at least to me, encountering this kind of mature yet realistic subject matters handled in such an emotional way in a video game was a completely new experience to me. Granted, there were some walking simulators before this, but I'm not familiar with that genre. Anyway, its atmosphere building is certainly the game's core strength, and it's also reflected in its narrative choices, because they don't affect much of the plot aside from one last binary choice at the end, but they certainly affect to its tone.
Admittedly, there are few instances where you can see the seams, so to speak, where a character's response is delivered neutrally enough to match with any possible choice. Once again, they're not numerous enough to kill the mood, and other than that, this game provides some masterclass acting. Especially Hannah Dell's lead performance as sensitive and contemplative, almost adult overwhelmed by her sudden gain of godlike powers, which cements Maxine Caulfield among the greatest player characters pantheon.
It feels so nice to just relax. This day has been so damn bizarre, and it feels like it has gone on forever. Maybe I'll just wake up now and find out I was dreaming all of this. Or like Poe said, a dream within a dream.
Okay, some Darcy lines verse on the edge of pretentiousness, but she's an arts major, what did you expect? Life is Strange is, dare I say it, hella impressive.
The gameplay may not be super nuanced, but in this case that's completely fine. How the story presents itself through the excellent performances, world building and characterization is phenomenal. And generally the writing, I mean, it has its awkward moments that can pull you out of the experience, but when its emotional mood clicks, the game can deliver some truly memorable moments. I understand that Life is Strange as, let's call it hipster aesthetic, may not be for everyone, but the first episode is free, so you'll get a pretty good impression on if that's your thing. All in all, a high recommendation from my part.
2 years later the game got a prequel, Before the Storm, but prequels rarely interest me. On the other hand, its sequel with a completely different set of characters that was finished last year... Maybe someday, once my financial stability is better. I'll try to churn out 2 more episodes before the year ends, but next time I'll have another point-and-click adventure with an art student trying to solve supernatural shenanigans, but that's where the similarities end. Until then, thanks for your time.